It's quite an honor to be here among all these distinguished faculty and graduates of the Keck School of Medicine of the University of Southern California. Today's accomplished graduates have painstakingly prepared themselves for careers in biomedical and biological fields, academic medicine, and independent research. They are poised to assume their new roles as practitioners, leaders, innovators, as skilled and knowledgeable caretakers of the vulnerable, sick, and injured, as inventors of therapies and cures, as discoveries of hidden mechanisms and processes. Today, we honor them not only for their achievements, but for their choice of profession. The graduates before us have chosen to pursue work dedicated to understanding and bettering the human condition. For that, we commend them and wish them long, successful, and productive careers. I am a developmental social neuroscientist, a psychologist, and an educator. I study relationships, culture, and how our experiences shape both our biology and our thoughts and our feelings. As I was thinking about what I might like to say to this distinguished group of graduates today and their families and friends, I thought I would talk about the power of emotion. For centuries, Western philosophers have strived to describe learned and educated people as those for whom emotion plays no role in their intellect, for whom emotions are suppressed in the service of clear-headed thinking, for whom rationality rules. Unfortunately, what we've learned from neuroscience and from psychology and psychiatry over about the past 20 years or more is that, in fact, rationality is an inherently emotional thought process. It is impossible to have meaningful thought, to have morality, to have purposefulness, to have innovation without emotion. Even today, we strive to separate emotion from reason, to distance our subjective perceptions of situations from our decision-making, and to clear our minds of emotion so that our thoughts can be justified and clean. I know this may frighten you, parents especially. I understand because I am myself a parent. But given everything we've learned about emotion and its power to steer the mind, I would urge you graduates to do the opposite. Aim not to distance yourself from your emotions, but to leverage your emotions as powerful motivators for change that you can wrought on the world. The source of all inspiration, of all passion, and of everything that is meaningful is its emotional connection to an underlying idea or purpose. But not all emotions are created equal. They differ in important dimensions, and to use your emotions well, to use them mindfully, to use them morally, to use them strategically for good in the world, you need to understand the difference between emotions. Some emotions propel you to act now. These emotions are those that keep you from falling off the edges of cliffs, that offer a hug to someone who looks sad, that make you lash out at someone with whom you may be annoyed. These emotions are very important. They steer your behavior, and they need active regulation to be used in ways that are safe and that are kind. But other emotions don't pertain to acting now, and these are the emotions that I would adjure you to try to cultivate in yourselves as you move forward with your work. These emotions are about the meaning you make of situations, the deductions you draw about the beliefs that drive people's decisions, including your own, the inferences you construct about why things happen as they do and how they could happen differently. These emotions are the stuff of values, of deep relationships, of cultural meaning-making. They are the emotions of possible futures, imagined worlds. innovations, discoveries, and of social justice and equality. My advice to you, if I can be so bold as to offer some, is that you learn to feel these emotions, and that everything you do and learn, you strive to put in their service. I understand that there are clinicians and public health experts and scientists and educators among you, and that as you continue your scholarly, professional, and personal lives, your journeys are not simply to advance your fields and to move through the ranks of achievement in your discipline or your chosen endeavor. I would argue that it's to learn how to feel. By that, I mean feeling as a process, as an effortful process, a painful sometimes process, an exhilarating sometimes process. I would advise you to work hard, dig in, to experiment and take risks and submerge yourself in what life has to offer. And when life doesn't offer, construct it for yourselves and bring others with you through the power of the meaning you make of the actions that you undertake, and not simply through the power of the actions themselves. You can bring others with you so that the world becomes a better place for your having been there. Because what matters, what divides good from evil, is how you feel. And I do not mean what you feel. I mean how. The process by which you evaluate and become aware, become conscious of your emotions and of the beliefs and the desires that are driving your and other people's actions. It's a process of learning to notice, learning to recognize the circumstances that call for action, even when those circumstances are not apparent at the surface. Learning to notice how your and others' actions impact others, or could impact others, if only you tried harder or more strategically. Learning to feel is a process by which your life and talents and skills take on meaning. In the neuroimaging lab, we've watched the amygdala light up when people react to stimuli we present, when people see things that cause them to have emotional reactions in response. And we've seen something else also, something that I would argue is infinitely more powerful to changing or sustaining the human condition, something that speaks profoundly to the power of emotion to heighten consciousness, to activate visceral somatic sensation. Emotions that are to do not with directly observable circumstances and actions, but with the values and beliefs and qualities of character and mind that undergird circumstances and actions. Emotions like inspiration, like awe, like compassion, like curiosity, like admiration for virtue. These emotions get their power not from the amygdala, not from that almond-shaped nucleus in your brain that fires to make you react in the moment, but instead from hijacking and repurposing the very same neurobiological systems that literally keep you alive. We even see medulla activation. The medulla is at the bottom of the brain, just above the spinal cord, as a part of the brain stem. We share the medulla with alligators. If you get damage in your medulla, your physiological homeostasis becomes dysregulated. You may stop breathing, your heart may stop beating, and you can die very rapidly. And when people are moved and inspired by the values that underlie circumstances and actions, we see activation in the medulla, consistent, strong activation in a part of one's brain that is essential for autonomic regulation and consciousness, functions that make you feel more alive, more aware, more awake. Our physical survival and our social survival, I would argue at this late stage in our human evolution, are completely intertwined with one another. We are no longer just bodies. We are bodies with minds that conjure meaning. And it's in that process that we find the full power of education. It means that only through learning to feel compassion, inspiration, awe, emotions, all of them that involve deep connection with other people, with yourself, and deep connection with powerful ideas. Only through finding these emotions can you fully live. And so, my hope for you as you celebrate today with your families and your friends, and then as you step over the threshold of Keck School of Medicine, is that you live your life in a place of deep emotion, that you live your life like you mean it. Thank you.